Behind me is, in this unassuming spot, is the remains of a little stream. When the pool site was excavated into the hillside, the stream was exposed. And it's still apparent now, dribbling down out of a hole in the wall. The interest of the stream is that it is fed by a spring about 100 yards up the hillside, and this is one of some 20 or so springs that used to exist in the area. The main concentration of these springs was in the area around Wells Park Road and Taylor's Lane in Upper Sydenham. They were discovered in about 1640 to apparently have medicinal qualities and became quite fashionable as a place to come and take the waters. There are records of several distinguished people who visited, including John Evelyn and Daniel Defoe. Daniel Defoe, when he visited, was not impressed and described the people who were visiting the springs then as a drunken rabble. Perhaps the best known was George III, who in the 1780s apparently spent a whole day here taking the waters. I'm now standing in front of the foundation stone, which was laid almost exactly a year before the pools were formally opened. The stone was laid by Theophilus Williams, who was the chairman of the commissioners for the pools, and it also tells us that the architects were Wilson and Aldwinkle. Theophilus Williams was a very active local politician, a charismatic man. He began his life in this area as a bank messenger at the original Barclays Bank building in Forest Hill, and got promoted to be bank manager of the Barclays building in Sydenham. He then went into local politics and was involved in almost every committee and group for about 20 years. He also, in 1901, became Lewisham's first mayor. However, he went into decline after that, and we don't hear any more of him until about 1908, when he was declared bankrupt. And during the hearing for his bankruptcy, certain matters came to light, and he was then charged with embezzlement and fraud and required to appear at Greenwich Crown Court. However, on the day of his trial, his landlady contacted the judge to say that Theophilus couldn't make it because he'd been found dead in bed. He'd apparently taken an overdose of morphine, which his landlady said he was known to have used on a number of occasions in the past. The unfortunate thing about this, of course, is that we don't now know quite what the details are of his misdemeanours. The Victorians felt very strongly that cleanliness was next to godliness, and that if people were clean on the outside, they would be clean and healthy on the inside too. Pools have always had a very important role in the social life of the area, and this is reflected in a picture we have of the funeral of Queen Victoria in 1901, where the pools were absolutely draped in mourning. We're now standing by the second-class ticket office. When the pools were originally built, they were built with a very strong sense of the social hierarchy of the time. So we have, in the pools, we have a first-class swimming pool and a second-class swimming pool, but we also have a first-class ticket office and a second-class ticket office. The ticket offices were for males only. Beyond the ticket offices, there was a first-class males waiting room and a second-class males waiting room. Women were added as an afterthought, really. They were supposed initially to go to Ladywell pools for their swimming, but it was decided that, in fairness, they ought to be allowed to come here, so they added, at the side of the building, a women's ticket office. The swimming was strictly segregated. There was no mixed bathing at all until in the 1930s, when for several hours on a couple of evenings a week, there was mixed bathing permitted. We're now standing in the first class pools with the gallery above, and the lockers would have been ranged around the side of the pool with curtains rather than doors to protect them. The gallery was available for people who didn't want to swim but were prepared to pay tuppence to come and watch the swimmers. During the winter months, the pools were closed to swimmers, and this pool, the first class pool, was boarded over and used for concerts and for public performances of various sorts, bazaars and fetes. And indeed, in 1951, Clement Attlee held an important public meeting here to announce that as a result of the threat to our way of life from the Soviet Union, Britain was going to undergo a period of post-war rearmament to protect our way of life. A curious indication of the sort of class system pools was that the freshly filtered water passed into this, the first class pools first, and then overflowed into the second class pools next door. And I've been told that this is still the case. The pools have also produced at least one world-class swimmer in Linda Ludgrove, who in the early 1960s held several world records and a couple of Commonwealth titles. We're now standing in what used to be called the first-class male slipper baths. Slipper baths were ordinary baths, small tubs that people could wash themselves in, and this was an important part of the cleanliness aspect of the Forest Hill pools. The attendant controlled the supply of water from the pipe and taps outside. People couldn't top their own baths up. There were clear windows to the cubicles, and in order to protect their privacy, the bathers had to hang their towels up against the window. Towel hire and indeed swimming costume hire was available, so people needed nothing when they came to the pools, apart from a small amount of money that it cost them to hire and pay to come in. And here we are down in the basement of the pools, in the main working area. There are essentially three areas. First, we'll have a look at the laundry area where the towels that were hired out would have been cleaned. First of all, they were put into a boiler and would have been boiled clean. The next process would have been to spin them in a spin dryer by centrifugal force. And finally, one of the nicest pieces of equipment is the dryer with rails and little hooks to hang the towels on. Made by an East London firm which survived until 1957 in Bessemer Green. The working environment down here must have been really quite unpleasant. It was hot, it was steamy, it was very, very noisy. This was a self-sufficient environment. All the maintenance for the machinery and pools would have been carried out down here. This is the filtration room. These tanks are the original 120-year-old filtration tanks, and we've been told on good authority that they still produce the cleanest swimming pool water in Lewisham. Originally, chemicals were added to the water by hand, but now the whole process is carried out automatically. The original power would have been provided by coal, but they have since been replaced by these gas-powered heaters. And that ends our tour of Forest Hill Pools.